Good afternoon. Welcome to Sports Nothing But Sports with Kent Sterling, brought to you by the great people at Today's Dentistry. Give them a call. Become Dr. Mike O'Neill's next new patient, 317-849-2933. We're out at the Colts Complex today, where a bunch of players were made available to the media. Braden Smith, Anthony Costanzo, Pierre Desir. I guess it's not a bunch. It's three guys. And what did we learn? We learned that Anthony Costanzo, his body feels better today at the age of 30 than it did when he was a rookie. And he was here for OTAs and rookie camp and stuff. He's worked hard to try to build the strength in his hips so his knees don't hurt, and his knees don't hurt for the first time in a long time. That's good news. This offensive line coming back intact for 2019. One of the reasons that people are so very bullish about the prospects of the Indianapolis Colts making it to the postseason again and maybe making a long run into the postseason. Those five guys have learned how to play together, and because of that, they figured out how to protect Andrew Luck, open up holes for Marlon Mack, and we expect that to continue in 2019. Kind of nice. The number of questions that we have for players and for coaches and for Chris Ballard, really kind of minimal. You know, the positional battles, there aren't a gob of them. Health issues, not a gob of those. The draft from 2018 was terrific. The draft from 19, we don't know what that's going to be, but we're going to have to wait to find out. Interesting stuff. One guy we'd like to hear from is Malik Hooker, to find out where he is physically, because he's a big part of what that defense needs to be in order for the Colts to succeed in 2019. The Chicago Cubs, oh, wait, before we get to the Cubs, the Warriors and the Blazers, game two tonight at Golden State. So the game being at the Oracle, who's winning that thing? I think it's going to be Golden State. I think the Bucks win their series in five. I think Golden State wins their series in five maximum. We'll see. That is the NBA Finals I want to see, because you've got Giannis Antetokounmpo as the best two-way player in the world, and you've got the Golden State Warriors as the best team in the world. I want to see how they face off, and I really, really like, I talked to Dan Dockich on his show today, and we were talking about both teams, and one thing I really, really like about the Bucks is Eric Bledsoe. I think he does a great job at the point on both ends of the floor, and that he's really important to their success. Without Eric Bledsoe, this is an entirely different team. I think they've got great component pieces, and if Brook Lopez can play in games 2, 3, 4, and 5 like he did in game 1, this is going to be a pretty quick series. All right, let's talk about the Cubs. Last night, they blew a lead. In fact, a couple leads. The Reds, they tie it in the 8th on a bomb by Suarez. So the game tied at 5. It goes to extras. And in the bottom of the 10th, Yasiel Puig, with the bases loaded, hits a ball about 400 feet to the base of the wall in center field. And the Reds, they walk off winners. A game that the Cubs should have won. But that bullpen, as good as it's been over the last month, you know what? It's still got great flaws. You don't really have a closer. You don't have anybody that you can count on to either throw strikes or get strikeouts, and that becomes a problem. So let's turn our attention to the Cubs and talk to the great Evan Altman from CubsInsider.com. If you don't spend a lot of time on CubsInsider.com and you're a fan of the Cubs, you're out of your mind, because Evan does an absolutely great job of covering everything Cubs-related.
All right, Evan, let me ask you first about Ben Zobrist, because I don't know what the hell's going on. I know there's a divorce thing, but can't you play basketball and get a divorce simultaneously?
Yeah, I would think so, although he's a baseball player, so that's different from basketball. So he's actually hooping right now. The Bulls need a lot of help. I guess they didn't get that. They got the number 7 pick, so they're going to sign him. But no, in all seriousness, yeah. I mean, you can, and it's. I think that's the difficult part of this whole situation. It's really weird. I think Cubs Insider, wherever we want to put that, was one of the first outlets to kind of put that out.
Right.
You know, outside of just social media. It was really interesting to get the flack from me. You know, like, oh, keep this private. I'm like, well, the alternative is to let everybody run with rumors. Right. And I think that's the difficult part. And I think when you have a guy who's been, you know, he and his wife have been very open about their faith, and they've been married for quite a while. And not that that is necessary, although I don't know. Everybody takes everything differently. And so you kind of wonder, on one hand, is he just completely unable to really function? Because I know his wife filed for divorce in Cook County in Illinois. He filed for separation in, I think, Williamson County, Tennessee. And there are some differences there, and there's a bunch going on. So, you know, I don't want to and he missed the start of spring training. So this could be something that's been going on for a long time. We look at, you know, he's had some kind of rough performances that's been dragging him down, and he just needs that time. But I don't know, how many times have we seen athletes who are going through really tough struggles and or really weird, you know, maybe it's really horrible things that they're accused of or that they actually did. But, hey, you get out on the field and you're between the lines and you kind of dial that in, and that is your way to sort of be able to cope. And that's kind of, you know, my thing is kind of along those lines. I don't have too many outlets like that. Writing is one of them for me, I guess, to where I could block everything else out and do that. And that kind of is my touchstone, my whatever return point, if you will, my reset button. So, yeah, you kind of wonder, man, wouldn't it be great, maybe better for him to be around his teammates, to be around the game, and that would probably help with the coping side of it.
Good guess.
But it's just, it's a tough deal, and that's why I try to, like, hey, let's put the facts out there and then sort of back away and let things play. But at some point, you wonder, does he come back at all? If he's not been able to be around the team for the last couple of weeks, is he ever going to be? And that's, I think, the tough part about it.
I kind of found him to be one of those guys, like Mark DeRosa was one of those guys, sort of the cultural guy who set the standard in the clubhouse and did some things on the field that were good, but he was more kind of a team captain type guy. But it seems like they haven't missed a beat without him, that if it wasn't, like if this wasn't a story, I wouldn't even notice he wasn't there.
Yeah, and I think the interesting thing about that, and in talking with some people, and this is never something that, you know, the Cubs players would come out and say or that you'd ever hear from the front office, but in sort of some of the behind-the-scenes stuff, and not that he's not a leader, certainly not that people don't like him or that he's divisive in any way, but he is very much like a homebody. He was not the guy who was hanging out with guys outside of the clubhouse. Not really the vocal leader. And you kind of saw that. And certainly there were a lot of Cubs fans that didn't like the acquisition of Daniel Murphy last year. But when a guy like Murphy came to the team, he and Zobrist kind of have, if you look at them, sort of some parallels just in terms of their personal lives, to some extent. Right. And just
right.
Sort of look, you're sort of the same type of guy in that regard. But Murphy was a guy who a lot of players gravitated to and talk hitting with. And so just immediately having come to the team, he sort of drew those young players to him. But Zobrist is not really that guy who's going out of his way to be vocal and approaching players. And I think he's sort of quirky and does his own thing and was really, really, really tied up and close with his family. And so that could be a part of what we're seeing here. But I don't think his absence or his presence as a leader was such that when you took that away, it really affected the team. So he's a good guy, good to have around, great player, has been a good addition. But I think we all from the outside sort of had a greater perception of what his impact really was to the team than what the reality of it was.
And still no timeline on his return or whether he's going to return, right?
Right, yeah, and the Cubs certainly aren't saying anything, but again, you sort of look at it and think, okay, you know, whether it's a death or a birth or something, and certainly those things are very different, and there's a, you know, the timeline is, those aren't legal proceedings and whatnot, but yeah, if you look at, as I kind of mentioned earlier, if the guy's already been away for a couple weeks, you sort of wonder, and this is apparently something that's been dragging out, you wonder, is he going to be able to come back at all? And does he just hang it up and say, you know, I'm done. And let's look at a parallel and what happened. And I don't want to relate the facts of either matter or the rumors of either matter, but Ryan Sandberg retired when he went through his divorce.
Right.
That first one. And we saw him leave the game for a while. Of course, he was much younger than Zobrist and able to come back. But even at that point, he was late in his career.
He did have that injury. He did get hit by a pitch, and so he was on the shelf for a physical reason, and then maybe came back a little bit too early and couldn't perform to his standards. There was that, but I get what you're saying.
Yeah, so you just kind of wonder, like, does he just look at it and say, you know what, my heart's not in it? Although, again, most people who are competitors like that, I think, would prefer to get back out there. I know I personally, hey, if there's something that I can do that's going to take my mind off this, that is going to allow me to focus and put me in and around people who can be really supportive of me in that sense. Hey, these baseball players, man, even today's game is a little bit different from what it used to be, but when that's kind of been your social network through right. your entire life from the time you were 5 years old, that's kind of the thing to me. If you can get back to some sense of normalcy, it's there in the clubhouse and on the diamond. So you'd like to think that would be helpful to him. But I guess at the end, we just have to hope that whatever he's doing is what's in his best interest and his family's best interest. And that, you know, only he knows that best. So ideally whatever gets done is better for him and for his family and however that works going forward.
Yeah, it would seem to be almost like a second divorce. I mean, when people separate from their professional life, that can become almost as deleterious to your psychology as getting a divorce. And so, you know, willfully inviting one after having another kind of thrust upon you would seem to be an odd choice. I couldn't agree more. Let's talk about Chris Bryant and the axe handle bat, which I don't really understand. What is going on with Chris Bryant's bat? We don't argue with results. It's been terrific. But what is this thing?
Yeah, so and as you say that, I am awaiting a delivery from UPS on an axe bat for my son.
Really?
Which I purchased at the on the advice of Mike Bryant, Chris's father, because I was talking with him about the bat. And so I initially heard about these things several years ago when Dustin Pedroia broke the hamate bone in his hand, similar to what we're seeing with Victor Caratini of the Cubs, who should be back within about a month of a broken bone and surgery for it. But it's the hamate bone is like at the base of your pinky finger and your ring finger, right?
Okay.
So it's a weird spot, and a hitter is going to break that bone on their lower hand. I'm getting it. This will actually make sense in a little bit. And it's on the outer portion of the wrist, so you're going to see it on the bottom hand is where it ever gets broken, because if you get hit by a pitch, that's the hand, you know, your top hand is facing back, right? So you don't have to worry about that one. But the problem is that's right at a spot where that knob of the bat is going to put pressure, and so of a traditional bat. So these axe handle bats, as you're used to, you know, there is no traditional knob down there. They taper off toward the end. And so the idea is that, first of all, it takes pressure off the hands there, but it also, the way that handle is set up kind of helps your knuckles to be aligned a little bit more easily and more naturally. And as Mike Bryant was telling me, and with Chris, this was a big deal because early on in the season when he was having his struggles, his hand path was a little bit goofy. And you want your lower hand, your top hand, a little lower than your bottom hand as you're coming through and making contact with the ball, so you have a little bit of an
right.
upward stroke. Chris's was too low coming in early, and he was kind of coming in under. That's why we saw him swing through so many pitches. And he started to come back around, but really what we saw when he went to the axe bat was there in Arizona, where he hit a couple home runs, and it really allowed him to kind of better align those hands and get his path correct through the zone. Part of it may be Dumbo could fly on his own, but, you know, the feather, he thought that was like the magic feather. And so,
right.
You know, I don't think it's totally a placebo by any stretch, but I think they're sort of self-fulfilling. But a lot of guys just really like it. If you think about if you've ever swung an axe, you know, you think about, well, this feels pretty comfortable
right.
in my hands, you know. And so you think about that same thing, slightly different motion, but it's that, you know, getting that top hand into the right position as you come through. And if there's anything, especially at that kind of elite level with somebody like Bryant, and you talk about just maybe a millimeter here or there, or, you know, just fractions of an inch, whether you want to use the metric system or, you know, more of an American style, whatever measurements you use, either way, that's the difference between maybe popping one up and driving one over the fence. So it seems to be working, and he likes it. So, hey, let's let it roll.
What's the deal with Anthony Rizzo, and when's he coming back? It says day to day, and you always hear day to day. But how close is he to returning?
He says, you know, maybe by the weekend. I know he said yesterday he thought he could have perhaps been available to pinch hit. I don't know that we see him, especially against the Reds' best starter here on Thursday afternoon, or late evening or early evening, whatever. I don't know that we see him in there, although the weather's starting to warm up, so that's going to help significantly. I think you get one of these days like we had He was in the 40s in Chicago, right? So if you got a stiff back, he just played 15 innings the day before. Not an ideal condition. And if you look at anything like that, you know, that's the he's had this kind of pretty frequently on and off. And so I think they're going to be extra cautious with him. Although I know it's supposed to be, I think, 85 tomorrow. And so that's the kind of thing where, you know, if it warms up a little bit and he can kind of get loose, I think we wait to see him probably when they go to Washington this weekend. But again, same deal, other than maybe last night kind of giving the game away. Chris Bryant's played pretty well at first and he's hitting. So it's the same thing, but eventually you can't just keep losing your top line players and filling them in and keeping things moving along. But hopefully against a team like the Reds, the Cubs can get a win without him. But yeah, I think they're going to hold him out as long as they possibly can, but I can't imagine that being more than a couple of games.
You know, you look at this team, Evan, and it's so rare in baseball to see not just the nucleus, but also kind of the sort of those peripheral guys stay together for this long. I mean, you look at like Bryant, Baez, Russell now at second, or if it's Zobrist, that's fine. Rizzo, Schwarber, you know, Fowler's gone, but you've still got Almora, you've got Hayward, Contreras behind the plate, and even down to a couple of guys on the bench. The nucleus of this team has been with this team. This is season 5, and that is really, really weird. I mean, almost unprecedented in this day and age with free agency, isn't it?
It really is, yeah. And I mean, I think that's a testament to their ability and to what, you know, if you look at 2015, there was the whole argument versus it was the Cubs who had developed bats to get to that level, and then against the Mets, who ended up prevailing at least that season and then completely fell off the map, that the Mets had done it all by developing pitching. And I think we've seen from that, you know, the Cubs have, and granted the Cubs still need and want to develop their own internal pitching, and that's definitely on the come at this point, but they've proven that, hey, if you can do that, and, you know, they certainly have yet to really extend other than David Bote, which is kind of an odd one, and he's not even in that core group, but they haven't really extended any of these guys, and so none of them are making a ton of money, and that's enabled them to go out and buy the pitching that they need to, or, you know, afford someone like a Jason Hayward when he was a coveted free agent. But, yeah, it's to be able to hit on all those guys and have those top first-round picks. A lot of people talk about, you know, there's this emphasis on tanking and getting high draft picks, and that's all well and good, but even if you're talking about top 10 guys, it's really unprecedented to have all the, and we could even throw Ian Happ kind of in that mix because he was a first-round pick. He's down in the minors. But if you look at having 5 or 6 consecutive first-round picks come up and contribute at the major league level, because, I mean, it was, and then, you know, because it was Almora, Baez before that, and then Almora and Bryant and Schwarber, all those, and Happ all coming up and contributing, and then you trade for someone like Russell who came up, you trade for someone like Rizzo when he was young, that's not normal to have all those guys come up and stick. I mean, how many flashes in the pan have we seen, especially with the Cubs? So yeah, I mean, you could, again, history is replete with guys who, you know, I mean, hey, Jerome Walton and Dwight Smith, right? Number one and number two in rookie of the year voting, and then never again were heard from, more or less. And so, you know, to see that happen and to have them all sort of, you know, there's ebbs and flows there, but, you know, generally you're going to have, you get a couple of superstars out of that mix, and then the rest of the guys can play roles. It doesn't really matter. But yeah, it's, I think, and there's 2 more years of that until they start finally having to, you know, pay some guys or move some. So it'll be interesting to see sort of how that plays out as these guys start coming due for some big paydays.
What's the matter with Dylan Maples? Speaking of guys, homegrown pitching talent, this guy, an almost unhittable, like a wiffle ball-esque type breaking pitch, but he can't locate. Why can't they get this guy to a position where he can throw strikes?
Yeah, that's the really, I mean, it's the million-dollar question with that four-seam, and it's sort of the same thing we saw until last night that we've seen at least this year with Yu Darvish, which is really kind of weird because normally you think, okay, fastball, fine, but most of these guys, they can't locate a secondary, which is why they would just hit hard, because if they know you just got to pump fastballs, they're going to sit on it. Maples, on the other hand, and what we saw with Darvish, he doesn't know where the fastball is going half the time, which is really bizarre because the pitch is, you know, it shouldn't be moving. And that's the problem, is that And for a guy like that, too, the other issue is that not only does he throw really hard, I mean, he's capable of hitting triple digits with the fastball, or at least in the high upper 90s, but he pitches backwards. So he pitches off the slider. He throws the slider more than the fastball, but the problem there is that, and we saw this happen to him a couple times, I want to say it was in Milwaukee, where he just lost any ability to locate a fastball and had to go purely with sliders. And even as good as that is, as soon as you make a mistake, they're looking for that pitch, and then you hang one and you get a cement mixer instead of the wiffle ball, right, it's going to go a long way in the other direction. And that's the issue, is in that confidence is lost. And if you can't show that, because if they are looking slider and you blow one at 99 past them, nobody's going to be able to touch him. But I don't even think he understands it. And that's the trouble, is just unless you can get that, and he's not young anymore. He's 26, 27 now. So you kind of got to hope he puts it together, because, man, when it's working,
right,
it's
like Kerry Wood.
Yeah. And he should be that guy. He could be, I mean, if that works, if that fastball is located, you put him in there in the ninth inning and just shut the door and it's done, right? Everybody can just go back to the clubhouse and shower, cause it's over. But, unfortunately that's not there, and he still hasn't quite gotten it. And until he does, he's going to keep bouncing back and forth.
You know, it's really interesting watching a game last night. I was so pissed at the Cubs bullpen, and the bullpen had been terrific and really has been, if not baseball's best, then among the best over the last month. But as soon as they start to fall apart, I get really angry. And that's not a failing of the bullpen. That's a failing of me, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, I think that's a given, right? you know,
right.
You're full of fault, as we all are. We're all human. But, I do think there's something to be said, though, for the guys that they've had to put in position. You know, if you had your druthers, Brandon Morrow's there in the ninth and Pedro Strokes in the eighth, or do that, and then you can really be a little bit more judicious with your use of some of these guys, like a Kyle Ryan or Carl Edwards, who should be, you know, all things considered. Again, you talk about stuff, but kind of the 10-cent head, if you will, and I don't want to be too disparaging of him, but I think we've seen enough from him to know that once the mental side starts sliding a little bit, you kind of lose him for innings at a time. And so the troublesome part is that they've had a lot of guys stepping up in good spots, but when you have some people who have not been in those positions, the fickle nature of the bullpen really starts to come out even more so, because you guys just don't have enough of that experience, and there's not enough. And we saw it with Brandon Kinsler giving up a home run. You know, he's a pitch to contact guy. They don't have, with Morrow out and with Stroke kind of, you know, he's out, he's been hurt too often over the last little while, they don't have a lot of guys who, again, like a Maples, who can miss bats. That's why somebody like him would be so important up there. They have a ton of guys who throw in the 80s and 90s, low 90s, and try to get by on ground balls, pitching to contact. And when you're talking about a bullpen, that's not the kind of thing that you can get away with very often.
Right.
You need somebody to go out there and get strikeouts, and they just don't. And so you will have that far too often, where then you're looking at last night where, okay, well, now you got to play a five-man infield and walk somebody and load the bases and hope to get a double play. And that, unfortunately, that's going to come back and bite you in the rear end every once in a while. And it did. And, you know, ideally they get back to kind of doing what they do best and having the defense do some work behind them. But until that point until they get some guys back healthy, there's going to be a lot of that. You just got to hope that they pitch to the right kind of contact.
Anybody worth mentioning down on the farm at this point?
You know, I think it's been kind of a weird season. You know, we've seen Nico Horner really busted out, and he got hit, and so he's been kind of down. There's a couple of guys in South Bend, and you know, I think at that point we can maybe start talking about them in a couple years. Dakota Mekas is one of them who I think we thought we would hear from, and he's starting to maybe, you know, do a little bit at this point. James Norwood, you know, another guy who we saw, fireballing pitcher. But at this juncture, I don't think there's enough really going on that we could say, hey, let's check these out. And I was trying to think of the kid, and for whatever reason now, the draft pick from last year escapes me. There's a kid down at South Bend in the outfield, and you know, had I known this, I would have done my research a little bit better. But because I actually literally just edited a piece yesterday about eight kind of top guys who are coming through. But, you know, at this point, it's, I think what we're going to need to expect is next year we start seeing some of these. Although I will say this, Oscar De La Cruz, let's go with that, because he's a guy who he was on an 80-game suspension last year from performance enhancing. He was actually like a masking agent. And he has looked really good since coming back. High 90s stuff, sharp breaking curveball, kind of moving up through, and he's at Double-A Tennessee right now. I think there's potential between him and maybe Adbert Alzolay, another name we haven't heard much of because he missed most of last season with a lat injury and just came back recently. Those guys, De La Cruz and Alzolay, could be options for the Cubs in the bullpen, because you talk about both of them with electric kind of stuff with the fastball breaking ball and the kind of guys who can miss bats. So as we just talked about with the bullpen, they could be some options if the Cubs need them here toward the second half of the season. So those would be the two names you're looking at. Who's going to impact the Cubs this year? I would look at those two. And, you know, again, if Horner can get back, he's going to start his hitting program again, I think, here this week in Arizona. And if he can get back going, I still think we see him at AAA this year and maybe in September in Chicago.
Excellent. Thank you. Great stuff, Evan. Appreciate it.
No problem. I try.
All right. That's great, Evan Altman from CubsInsider.com. I got to tell you, if you're a Cubs fan and you don't spend a significant amount of time reading the coverage of the Chicago Cubs at CubsInsider.com, you're making a mistake. They do it as well as anybody in the business. Evan Altman, always a great time talking to him. And really, the Cubs bullpen last night just absolutely stunk. But you know what? If they win tonight, you've got a team that has won or split every series that it's played going back to April 7th. So I got no problem with it. You know, every once in a while, bad things are going to happen. Suarez hits a two-run bomb last night in the bottom of the eighth for the Reds. Puig ends the game with a bases-loaded single, which would have been probably would have been a flyout if the guys weren't cheating in, the outfielders weren't cheating in. But at any rate, they get the loss last night. See what happens tonight and over the weekend. We'll talk to you tomorrow morning. Breakfast with Kent, brought to you by the great people of Today's Dentistry. That always at 8 o'clock on Facebook Live, and then immediately thereafter on Periscope Live. Sports news, you know what? I know the Pacers, the Colts, IU, Purdue, Butler, they're dormant right now, but that doesn't mean there isn't a lot of sports stuff going on. Practice at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, the NBA draft coming up, mini camps, OTAs, all that stuff with the Colts, pre-draft workouts for the Indiana Pacers. You got the combine going on up in Chicago. Lots to talk about. Indiana, still with two scholarships to give. Trenton Watford is going to declare on Monday. Likely not for Indiana, but we'll keep an eye on that too. We'll talk to you tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock, Breakfast with Kent, brought to you by the great people at Today's Dentistry. Talk to you then. Join me, for goodness sake.